That was old enough. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank you that you call gather your people around your word so that we may hear your voice, so that we may continue to grow in grace and knowledge. We thank you that even as Jesus calls Israel to repentance for the last time, that it is also a message to reach our ears, to reach our minds, so that we may continue to learn and grow, that our faith may be strengthened, that we may be encouraged in you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Okay, last week we began a larger section of Matthew's Gospel account in which Jesus calls Jerusalem to repentance for the last time. And all this material is grouped in threes. There are three incidents within the temple, three parables of repentance, three disputes between Jesus' enemies as he calls them to repentance. And finally, as Matthew draws closer to the time of Jesus' crucifixion, the judgment of God hangs heavily over Jerusalem for its refusal to repent. And you hear probably the harshest and most stern words of Jesus that we ever find recorded in the Gospel accounts. Now we always have to remember that when God uses that kind of language, it is meant to be a strong speaking of the law that people would be convicted, and then when he speaks the word of gospel, that they turn and behold who he is. So, all of this occurs during the Passover week, from his triumphal entry into Jerusalem and up through his crucifixion is all part of the Passover feast. And since we're going to finish this section, I'm going to back up to question 5 on your sheets. The incidents recorded here are the Passover week among the Jews. Read Exodus 12, 1 to 27, and familiarize yourself with Passover and how it was observed. Exodus 12. Its head with its legs and its inner parts. and you shall have none of it remain until morning. Anything that remains until morning you shall burn. In this manner you shall eat it, with your belt fastened, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. And you shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and on all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are, and when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague will befall you or destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be for you a memorial day, and you shall keep it as a feast to the Lord throughout your generations. As a statute forever, you shall keep it as a feast. 7 days you shall eat unleavened bread, and on the first day you shall remove leaven out of your houses. For if anyone eats what is leavened from the first day until the seventh day, that person shall be cut off from Israel. On the first day, you shall hold a holy assembly, and on the seventh day, a holy assembly. No work shall be done on those days, but what everyone needs to eat, that alone may be prepared by you. And you shall observe the feast of unleavened bread, for on this very day I brought your host out of the land of Egypt. Therefore you shall observe this day throughout your generations as a statute forever. In the first month, from the 14th day of the month at evening, you shall eat unleavened bread until the 21st day of the month at evening. For 7 days, no leaven is to be found in your houses. If anyone eats what is leavened, that person shall be cut off from the congregation of Israel, whether he is a sojourner or a native of the land. You shall eat nothing leavened. In all your dwelling places, you shall eat unleavened bread. Then Moses called all the elders of Israel and said to them, go and select lambs for yourselves according to your clans, and kill the Passover lamb. Take a bunch of hyssop and dip it in the blood that is in the basin, and touch the lintel and the two doorposts of them with the blood that is in the basin. None of you shall go out of the door of his house until the morning, for the Lord will pass through to strike the Egyptians. And when he sees the blood on the lintel and on the two doorposts, the Lord will pass over the door and will not allow the destroyer to enter your houses to strike you. You shall observe this rite as a statute for you and for your sons forever. And when you come to the land that the Lord will give you, as he promised, you shall keep this service. And when your children say to you, what do you mean by this service? You shall say, it is the sacrifice of the Lord's Passover, for he passed over the houses of the people of Israel in Egypt, when he struck the Egyptians, but spared our houses. And people bowed their heads and worshiped. This is the festival that we find that the Jews observing very strictly from the time that Jesus enters, as we read last week, into Jerusalem, and when they challenge authority and when he curses the fig tree for their professing to be faithful because he observed the letter of the law but not the intention of repentance and love. And that brings us to the three parables. So the three parables begin in Matthew 21, verse 28. So he's still speaking to chief priests and the elders. When they challenged him on his authority in 23 to 27. And so he's addressing them as he was speaking in 28. And what do you think? A man had two sons. And he went to the first and said, "Son, go and work in the vineyard today." But he answered, "I will not." But afterward, he changed his mind and went. And he went to the other son and said the same. But he answered, "I go, sir," but did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father? They, the chief priests and the elders, said, "The first." Jesus said to them, "Truly I say to you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes go into the kingdom of God before you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him. And even when you saw it, you did not afterward change your minds and believe." So, what's the message of this parable of repentance? Who are the disobedient ones and who are the obedient ones?
Well, in this particular case, I think it's a matter of repentance. It's not what you say, how you live.
Right. Repentance is not a matter of just what you say you're going to do, but if you say, "I'm sorry," you live as if you're sorry. If you say, "I have sinned, I will sin no more," does the life show a struggle not to sin? It doesn't mean that we become sinless, but at least you see the efforts. Often the repentant people are the ones who are the most broken. It's ones who continually over and over again keep saying, "I just don't seem to quite get it together. Why is that? Why do I have all these good intentions and then never are able to fulfill the intentions?" Well, it's rather simple. We were born sinful, redeemed by Jesus Christ. It's not our effort that makes us right with God, it's the forgiveness of sins. Living in forgiveness is always an uneven pattern, but it's there with the strong.
Sure. I have a background question. The Pharisees and scribes are the equivalent to the lawyers and the police force today. Do they have the force of the law behind them for the area?
Yes.
Okay, so they can basically seize people, property, things.
Sure.
And then the Pharisees make the charges and they complain.
Okay, you've got your three groups. Okay. You've got your Sadducees. Who are they?
They didn't believe in the resurrection.
Pardon?
They did not believe in the resurrection.
Right, they did not believe in the resurrection, and that's why we always say they're sad, you see. Within the Jewish system, who are the Sadducees?
They're like the priestly line, right?
They're the priestly line. They're the ones that ran the temple rites, the sacrificial system. All of the priests and the high priest came from the Sadducees. So, who were the Pharisees?
Teachers of the law.
Not teachers of the law.
Keepers.
Keepers of the law, yes. Keepers of the law, definitely. They were lay people. All you guys out there?
Yeah.
All you have to be a Pharisee. Yeah, sorry, Andrew Lloyd Webber. Stole your line. Jesus Christ Superstar. I always wanted to be a Pharisee. Yeah. Pharisee was a layperson who devoted themselves to being the nation's religious police. They made sure that all the lay people followed the law. Scribes, who were they?
They wrote down violations.
Oh, they also, they did more than that. They were theologians. They were the commentators. So when you subscribe to the Concordia commentary series and you get these things written by, you know, Jeff Gibbs and by Art Joss and by Jim Feltz and by all these other people, so you have a commentary. Or if you look in front of your Concordia Study Bible and you look at the list there, you know, from Engelbrecht Supreme down to our regional vice president, Scott Murray, and all these people who had written those notes that you see on the bottom. Those are the Christian, today's equivalent of the scribes. Now, the High Court, the Supreme Court of the nation, was composed of 70. 70 Sadducees, 70 Pharisees. So it was a split priest and lay court. This was a court. This is the High Court that tries Jesus. They have the force of law. The only thing that they couldn't do while the Romans occupied them is they could not officially give a public death sentence. They could still issue a private death sentence. Public, you know, is the one where anybody can come out and see the spectacle. Crucifixion is a public execution. If you got caught in adultery, the local town elders, without announcing it, could kill you by stoning. Pharisees had that force of law behind them. Yep. Thus, the woman caught in adultery before Jesus, you know, they cite the law and say, should we start her to death? And Jesus says, fine. He who among you is without sin, cast the first stone. You know, we often say, well, the Jews couldn't have the death penalty. Well, they couldn't have the public death penalty, but they could have the private, where the town elders, the village elders, they still have the force of law behind them. Confiscate your property? Too bad. Yes. Religious violations? You could be banned from the congregation of Israel.
And they're looking at 613
laws that God never heard of that they were enforcing. Yep. Yep. Yes. And that was their people. And so he speaks to these people, and the point of the parable is, you who are, you know, the priests and the elders, and you're dealing with Sadducees and Pharisees. You're the ones who said, we're serving God. So don't do it. Because the big word in here, what was the big word in this parable? In English, it came out what? The first son said, I ain't going. But then he changed
his mind.
Repented. It's the Greek word,
repent,
change. Turn around. Did the opposite. The other son couldn't go. And so, when we think of the arrival of Jesus on the scene, or the arrival of John the Baptist, the forerunner, who was it that's running out to hear John preach. He's not the chief priest. And so, Jesus says here in verse 31, truly I say to you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes go into the kingdom of God before you. You want the most public sin? Being a tax collector or a prostitute is the most public thing that the chief priests or the priests and the elders hate. And Jesus is saying, they go in. Why? They're the ones that heard John preaching and ran out to hear and said, we need forgiveness. And they went through that baptism of repentance.
So we had to get higher opinion and criticize each other and basically silence him by execution. But John criticized basically incest.
Okay.
Got it.
And it's a great image. I mean, your side of the room, you have to be Judah or Israel, as they call themselves. We over here are outside of Israel. We're a bunch of Gentiles. And this is the Jordan River. Paul's getting awfully wet, standing in the middle of the Jordan River. So John leaves Israel proper, comes over here and starts his preaching, and calls people to come out of Israel because they're not being faithful. They're not ready. So when they get baptized, how do they get back into Israel? When they're repentant, sorry for their sin, they come back and ready to start again. It's what they do. The chief priests say, why is John doing this? By what authority is he doing it? And, you know, what gives him the right? Jesus says, well, okay. You know, it's the question you ask me, by what authority I'm doing it, but by what authority did John do it? Well, the people were sorry for their sin. They started off. Chief priests and the elders, no, they weren't sorry. So, and when you saw what John did, you did not afterward change. Anything else on that parable? Next parable. Here another parable. There was a master of the house who planted a vineyard and put a fence around it and dug a wine press in it and built a tower and leased it to the tenants and went into another country when the season for fruit brought near. He sent his servants to the tenants to get his fruit. And the tenants took his servants and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. And he sent other servants, more than the first, and he did the same to them. And finally he sent his son to them, saying, they will respect my son. But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him and have his inheritance. And they took him and threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. When therefore the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? They said to him, he will put those wretches to a miserable death and let out the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the fruits of their seasons. Jesus said to them, have you never read in the scriptures, the stone that the builders rejected has become the capstone, and this is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous to the Lord. Therefore I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people producing its fruits. By the one who falls on this stone will be broken into pieces. And when he falls, when it falls on anyone, it will crush him. When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard these parables, they perceived that he was speaking about them. And although they were seeking to arrest him, they feared the crowds because they held him to be a prophet. One of my favorite parables. In the second parable, the old parable of vineyard, illustrates the crisis that the leaders are facing because they reject the kingdom of God and reject his son. God has sent his servants, and think about how many servants has he sent? If you think of all the prophets that came during the time of Judges, the time of 1st and 2nd Samuel, you know, who was in a sense the last of the judge, and the judge were very much prophets, and people would come back to faith, they'd fall from the faith. God will listen to his judgment. What about the prophet? You know, we have Elijah and Elisha. The ones that wrote the most that we call the major prophets. You know, and not many of them lived to old age. What happened? They got executed. Didn't like their message. Amos was executed. Isaiah was executed by Manasseh. Jeremiah was carried off into exile. He didn't listen to him anymore. And you look at, you know, Daniel, you look at the end of so many of these prophets, don't like the message. So you kill the messenger and hopefully silence the message. All of this comes from this parable. And then finally, again, you know, we see God inviting people into his kingdom. What's the fruit? It's the repentance and faith. And basically, Israel wants to take it, get rid of the sun, get rid of the air, so they can do everything they want. And God will give the kingdom to those who bear its fruits and repentance and faith in Jesus. Notice their response. They finally get it. Jesus speaking about the curse of the fig tree. Jesus not answering their question about authority. Jesus' parables, all these parables are now referring to them. And their response is not to hear God's word, not to faith. Their response is, kill God. But why don't they kill him?
Afraid.
Afraid. Afraid of the people. Remember last week I was trying to get you to, ignore those comments that the crowd was so fickle that they cheered him on, Palm Sunday and to crucify him on Good Friday. Notice all the way through this section, you've got two major groups. The priests and the Pharisees, they want to get rid of Jesus. The people who have heard his preaching, who have repented, they recognize him either as a prophet or as truly who he said he was, the Son of God. They're the believing mass. You've got about 20% control and power structure. is already in this plan. We want to figure out how to arrest them. Want to get rid of them. But it's not people who change their mind. Say, Jose, our son David, on Sunday, he all crucified on the bread. These people faithfully follow.
I have a hard time seeing anything except the Jewish and controlling class as this is a fear of loss, personal loss, physical loss, perceived human powers. This, it's all about I'm losing, which makes me think is I'm a big one to think that power is a big fantasy we've all bought into. We don't have any.
But basically, yes. The Sadducees and the Pharisees, they hate Jesus because he's attacking this whole structure that they created. If you're a priest, you make your living how? Offering. Sacrificial structure. I mean, people bring a certain amount to God that gets burnt up of wheat or grain as a sacrifice, as a foreshadowing to cover your sins until Christ comes. However, a portion of that wheat and a portion of that grain becomes the priest's property. Well, if all the people are donating meat and grain, there's much more than I need to feed myself and my family. So now I basically open up a grain store and a meat market. So besides being fed and housed, I am creating income from this. Jesus comes through and says, I will fulfill all of this. We don't need the temple or the sacrificial system anymore. And now, it's a threat of loss of position, of power, and income. Jesus attacks the whole power structure. They don't know how to live tomorrow if they don't have a temple. So, out of those people, whom do we not have anymore among the Jews? No Sadducees. Sadducees are gone. Temple's gone. Sacrifice is gone. Whom do we still have? The Pharisees. Where do we see them? All of you that live on the eastern seaboard? Yeah. Who are the Pharisees? They're the ones that continue to dress in black and white and have the long rock of hair on the side. They're still the Pharisees. They're still there. They are the Orthodox in the state of Israel. The Hasidim, as they're called. Yes. They're still there. Because after all, they were lay people. They had very little position except on the Sabbath. And where did they get their income? Their day jobs. They were lay people. They're just like David and Paul, only two elders present today, who, if we're not taking offerings anymore, they're still elders. The only one threatened is me. So if Jesus shows up and says, we're going to go for another few years, but we're just going to get rid of all the pastors. Yeah. We know who's going to be struck. It's going to be threatened to the Christian church. We have a lot of that going on, too. I mean, every time you try to think of, we don't need a full-time president in some districts anymore. We don't need a full-time staff president. Just like C.F.W. Walton, parish pastor who just happens to serve voluntarily in that position.
Those kind of things are always there. We perceive we have power.
Okay. So, with this parable of repentance, we find out what they do, and then we get into Matthew 22, the parable of the wedding feast. Probably one of my favorite parables, and the one that I get in the most trouble with. And again, Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king." Here's your point of comparison. "Who gave a wedding feast for his son? And he sent his servants to call those who were invited to the wedding feast, but they would not come. Again, he sent other servants, saying, 'Tell those who are invited, see, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding feast.' But they paid no attention and went off, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his servants, treated them shamefully, and killed them. The king was angry, and he sent his troops and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. And then he said to his servants, 'The wedding feast is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore to the main roads and invite to the wedding feast as many as you find.' And those servants went out to the roads and gathered all whom they found, both bad and good. And so the wedding feast was filled with guests. But when the king came to look at the guests, there he saw a man who had no wedding garment. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding garment?' He was speechless. And the king said to the attendants, 'Bind him hand and foot and cast him into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen.'" What's the message about repentance here? Who are the first called?
The obvious sinners.
Pardon?
The obvious sinners.
Israel.
Israel. Right. God's people. They're called to the wedding feast. But they're just too busy. I like Luke. One says, when this parable is told in a different situation, and Luke records it, one says, "When I bought a field," let's see what it is. "I just got married. I just bought a cow." And I always like to say, I bought me a wife and married a cow. But basically, it's just the excuses. And they come up with all the excuses. And no one pays attention to the call. Of course, we know the servants. They've been through this already. The servants of the prophets. And so then he goes out and calls the rest. To the Jewish ears, this is like calling the Gentiles. Those that you would call God-fearers, the good, and those who have paid no attention to God, the smart, the bad. And invites them to the feast. The next part's a little hard to understand. When does he demand of the person that's not wearing a wedding garment?
Did all the others have wedding garments? If they took him off the streets, how did they have time to get garments?
When you go to a Jewish wedding, you get a cover. So all the guests are the same. So no one is adorned more or less than the others. You are given a cloak.
It's provided.
It's provided.
Oh, I see.
It is provided. When you throw a wedding feast, it's provided. And a person says, no, thank you, I don't need that. I can walk in just as I am. So he rejects the garment given to him when that was provided. So the Lord of the Feast says, I invited you here. And you come on my terms. And you reject my terms. We have a lot of those, not only in the church of death, but in the church of heaven. Jesus is very clear. You're going to be baptized if you're going to be part of the kingdom, right? Whether you understand what baptism is, whether you understand it's a sacrament or not, or the end of it is a reform thing, and think of it as a forgiveness, you're going to be baptized. Why? Because Jesus said, you're not going to just ignore it. You're going to gather together with the people, because Jesus says, this is what I'm impressing. This is what I'm going to tell you. Your sins are forgiven. I'm only doing it on a weekly basis. I wish I was doing it every day. We need it every day. But I don't do it on a weekly basis. I invite you to my table. Wow. I neglect this table. And then, there are things like, I want you to gather regularly, and I want you to be taught, and I want you to be raised in the Word, and I want you to come to where I am present and respond to me with the words I give you. But besides, you need a shepherd. How many times in the Bible does it say, every group of people needs a shepherd? And we've got congregations that say, you know what? We can get rid of baptism. We can get rid of the Lord's Supper. Boy, we sure don't need pastors anymore. I mean, right now, you know, we can, jerseys can be the place where we gather. Yeah, Jeff can be the spiritual leader. He can pour out the wine and throw out the pretzels there, and we're going to have a supper. That movement is now being christened up, right? It's called faith communities. And we can exist as faith communities. We don't need pastors anymore. We have big congregations that struggle to get pastors. We're not ever saying, why do we need one? We're doing just fine the way we are. That's the last time I got in trouble with this. With this parable. I told her, no, you're not fine. Thinking you don't need a pastor. Yeah. I was sure they'd never invite me back again. But yes, that the whole idea here is, what is repentance? And how do you, okay.
I was just thinking there's a really strong analog with Passover itself. Because you either put the blood on the doorpost or not. It doesn't matter whether you understand it. It doesn't matter whether know how it works, or whether you can talk yourself out of it, or whatever. The end of the day, you either catch the blood on the doorpost, or you don't.
Yes. Yeah, we often try to figure things out too far. How does it work? I don't know. God says, do it. Yeah. God says, don't come out of that door after you do it, because then the judgment's going to fall on you just like all the unbelieving. And then some people think, well, what about those who didn't do it, didn't God give them a chance? Well, let's see. If you're in Egypt, there were 10 plagues, probably more, at least 10 that are documented. And it's God's all, so you've had a long time to repent. And we know that some of the Egyptians did get it. And they heard that God will pass over if you sacrifice the lamb and put the door, you know, paint your door with the blood. And they did. And they did participate in Exodus. We know that. Why? They heard what God said. They didn't. And that's simple for us. We hear what God says, we do it. So how does that repentance come about? Just the way you said. We hear what God says. Instead of saying, I'm doing it my way, we walk into it this way. Yes?
In each parable, there's always a lesson from what Jesus didn't say. And in this particular one, you would think that Jesus, after having all these people that didn't want to come to the feast, we would say he would call the good. But he didn't say that. He said, the bad and the good would come.
So he continued to even call those who up to this point had not repented.
Right.
God's merciful call is always to all.
And
that's why we don't give up offering God's gospel to all.
And the same thing happened in the previous parable. He should have said, we think that all those miserable murderers, they're mass murderers, they should be killed. But instead, he points to the scripture that says that he is the cornerstone of the church that saves.
What? You always continue to keep that door open because you never know when someone will turn. You know, we have examples, not only in the scripture, but examples throughout life of people who say, no, 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 no. Okay. Because the word finally gets them. I don't want to draw examples to other things that happen in our lives when people word you down. Yeah, but that does happen. God has a way, because his word is not just words. We believe that the Holy Spirit works with the word. Third article of the Apostles' Creed. I cannot by my own reason or strength come to my Lord Jesus Christ or believe in him, but the Holy Spirit has called me by the dynamite, the power of the gospel. It's the word continues to work. It's not just like reading the newspaper or the history book. When you read these words, the Holy Spirit is working with it to bring about that repentance. And, yeah, Gene already answered at the beginning what question 8 was getting at. When you said, do you think God's call to repentance and faith should awaken in us? It's the life that follows, not just a verbal statement, but the life that follows. When you think of that, well, think of it again for those that are in second service today. That commitment made by, you know, a couple that says, yes, I would be faithful to Jesus Christ, even suffered death, they were all the way from the faith. That's a tough statement to make when you're 13, 14, 16. Well, because, you know, life can last a little while. I didn't realize what I was saying when I was 13. Okay, anything else on these parables? this way. Because next we'll deal with the three big questions before we get to 23. But we should finish 22 next week. Yes.
You know, we're talking about parables. And a parable, you mentioned how and why. A parable came to my mind that I feel is kind of reflective of why we repent and God thinks of us. And it's a short little parable that I can share.
Which one?
Well, it's it's about a tribe in Africa. It's not from the Bible parable. It's a parable from where there was a man who had a daughter who was very shy and kind of homely, and he would be lucky to get a goat for her, but not a cow. But lo and behold, a young man came and gave 10 cows for her. Not only 10 cows, but and like, you know, egg-laying hens, and 20 goats. And he was astounded that he gave his daughter to him to wed, and so he became rich. And lo and behold, over time, people saw that she was not only but beautiful, and not shy, but, you know, outgoing and loving. And one day, you know, the wife shyly asked her husband, why did she pay so much for me when really you could have gotten me for a goat? And he smiles at her and says, I always wanted to marry a 10-cow woman that came from a rich family. You know, doesn't Christ do this for us? You know, we're looked at like we're not worth even a goat. And yet that he showers his love and this gift. And just as she became beautiful, you know, a repentance of her view of herself and who she was and her relationship with her husband. So through God's love to us, you know, we can reflect him and repent rather than stay our old selves. And that's what came to mind.
Yeah, well, you know, by our value, we all have to say that we are unworthy sinners. But God looks at us that we were made in his image. Mm-hmm. And therefore he continues to pursue us. And we have great value to him. Mm-hmm. Before we're born, and even when we're sitting around saying, why in the world do I be living so long? And having to deal with all these unpleasant end of life situations. That's what we do.
He only sees us in the image of God after justification, though, right?
Even though we are not yet in Christ, he sees us as having value, being made in the image of God, fallen, albeit, but in the image of God. Every human being carries that word differently. That's why he goes to such extent in these parables to continue to call those who have obviously rejected him, want to arrest him, and want to kill him. He's still offering the chance to turn and live.
I'm still trying to write into the earth that it's the image of God until Adam and Eve start to have a fall and start having kids, and then it's the image of
Adam. It's the perfect image of God until the fall. It's now a tarnished image. It's still the image of God. And how valuable is it? Take a look at the cross. And Jesus died there on the cross. The people that put him there, and he still wants to redeem them.
That's what Jeff and I were saying in response to kind of your question, whatever. I think he valued us so much before the justification that that's why he sent his son.
Right.
I try to think about it as in terms of my preference. They somehow always looked at us and saw us as better people than I knew we were.
So, he sees us as we are. And
That's why, even when we think, I have no purpose left in this world, I have no value, I'm not doing anything good, I'm suffering from this disease and this disease and this disease, and two of the three of them, you know, have this chronic, progressive, and I'm going to end my life with it, sort of thing. Why am I here? Because I'm valuable to God. I'm valuable to the other people that God puts in my life. I may not understand the purpose and be able to smurf it out, you know, to know exactly why I'm here. Nevertheless, God sees that value. With that, let us conclude with the benediction of the Lord. Praise the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen.